Tragedy and horror in Florida. A gunman opened fire inside a school. Today, students walk out across the country and right here. A protest, 17 minutes for the 17 lives lost.
This is not acceptable.
The question tonight, how do you keep Wisconsin students safe? An assault weapons ban or arming teachers? It's a 12 News special, Guns and Schools.
Good evening. It was a historic day here in southeastern Wisconsin and across the country. Students walking out of school wanting more gun control.
Tonight we're having an in-depth conversation about guns and schools. Our reporters ask students what they want when it comes to keeping them safe. We also have gun advocates here in our studio. We'll talk to them coming up in just a bit. We want to start though with reporter Terry Sater. He's at Waukesha North High School tonight. Terry?
And Patrick, students here at Waukesha North really took remembering the Florida victims to heart. There were tears during today's walkout.
We're not going to feel safe in school because we walked out of school. We are walking out of school so that we can inspire a change.
Waukesha North student Taylor Lato helped lead a walkout at 10 this morning that lasted 17 minutes, 1 minute for each life lost in Florida's school shooting.
I just hope to keep the momentum going. I hope to continue having an open narrative where multiple people feel like they can have their voices heard so that we can all work together to fix this problem.
Students say they hope to inspire politicians to make schools safer.
Maybe about less than a third of our students across the district that participated in events.
Waukesha School Superintendent Todd Gray says the walkouts at several schools went smoothly.
A peaceful demonstration where they're not disruptive to other classrooms was fine.
And student leaders say, Patrick, that they had more students take part in the walkout here than they anticipated.
But Terry, one more thing. You had a chance to talk to the students about assault weapons. What'd they say?
And Patrick, I asked them, should assault weapons be banned? Only one student would answer the question, the others saying they didn't want to get caught up in the politics of it. But here's what that student said.
Do you think assault weapons should be banned?
I think it's important for everyone to get educated on what they think the decision should be and vote accordingly. So.
And students here at Waukesha North said that they wanted adults, voters, to decide what change should be made to make schools safer. Patrick?
And Terry Sater reporting live from Waukesha North High School.
I'm joined now by our special guest, State Representative Joe Sanfilippo, Republican from New Berlin, and gun rights advocate Nick Clark with Wisconsin Carry. You may not have heard it directly from more students at Waukesha North, but all day long we've been hearing about students who say they do want assault weapons ban. A majority of Americans do in the latest polls as well. Is that a good call?
Well, I think that, you know, we have to kind of take a step back, right? Because every weapon really is an assault weapon, right? It can be used for that purpose. So I think that if you're going to focus on the weapon itself, you have to really take a look at what's causing that. And, you know, an all-out assault weapon is something that's considered a fully automatic weapon, which isn't legal in the country right now. I think that we have to spend more time looking at what the root cause is of the problems that we have before we start taking steps like that. You know, from a political standpoint, that would be the easiest thing for politicians to do. Mandate background checks on every sale, ban certain types of weapons. But I'm not looking for the easy political out. What I'm looking for is the good policy that is going to really effectuate a change.
Well, I think what the kids are saying is they want something done because we've had this conversation go on again and again. Nick, I wanted to ask you the similar question about, if not assault weapons, which I assume you don't want them banned, what about the magazines that carry rounds up to 100?
Sure. Well, in the example of the Florida shooting, I think he only used 10-round magazines. He had multiple magazines from what I've read. And also, I think a lot of people don't understand what an assault weapon is. I think sometimes people are just, you know, if they watch the news and they hear the term, they're not sure what that really means. I think sometimes on the political side, especially coming out of D.C., there's a lot of talk about assault weapons as weapons of war. And I think that is confusing and misleading as well, because the typical AR-15 type weapon, that's not used in combat. It's a gun that's very similar to guns used for hunting. It looks a little bit different, has a few different cosmetic features. But with regard to high-capacity magazines, I mean, in the Virginia Tech shooting, that shooter came in with a backpack, multiple handguns, and multiple magazines. So it takes about a half a second to drop a magazine out and put another one in, so it just isn't a solution in terms of making an effective difference.
But may I interrupt you here? Because mm-hmm. in the days after the Parkland shooting, we heard from student Emma Gonzalez, and her quote was, "We need to pay attention to the fact that this was not just a mental health issue. He would not have harmed that many students with a knife." And I think that's probably what the core of the student's argument when it comes to assault weapons.
Well, sure. I mean, if we could ban guns, you would have less gun deaths. But I think that the practical matter is there's around 300 million guns in the country, so that's just not an option. And what we've seen is that banning guns ends up just leaving them only in the hands of people who would use them to do harm. And so should we sacrifice the rights of hundreds of millions of Americans who own guns in order to try to prevent a few of these mass shootings? I think there's better options out there.
I want to talk about threats that we saw today, because police arrested a Pewaukee High School student following a threat that canceled classes today.
These kinds of behaviors and these kinds of actions can have a real detrimental effect on the students that are involved. And that's why part of our release was to ask parents to have conversations with students and talk about how serious these things are.
The student made the threat on social media. The sheriff believes the student was working alone. And at Maquanago High School, threats of a planned shooting prompted the cancellation of the walkout. Officials determined that threat was not credible. Milwaukee police also responded to reports of a gun at Pulaski High School. A bus driver suspected a student had a gun in his backpack, but no weapon was found. So, Representative Sanfilippo, what do you think about that? Should there be harsher penalties for people who phone in these kinds of threats?
Yeah, first of all, I'm very glad that our local law enforcement here has taken those threats to heart and have done something about them, because we looked in the case of the Parkland shooter, that wasn't the case, right? The FBI received multiple tips. The sheriff's office was called many times to this young man's house. Even the school district itself knew that he was a troubled child in school and did nothing about it. So the system, there was a complete breakdown of the system in Parkland that failed. We have stiffened the penalties for kids who call in and make threats like this, and I think we absolutely have to be harsh on them, because there's certain things that you do and you don't do, and you would expect that these kids would be getting that education at home and from their parents, but unfortunately when that doesn't happen, then we do have to step in with the law and make sure that they understand the gravity of the situation that they cause and why they can't be doing those things.
And Mr. Clark.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things that we see over and over is a lack of punitive measures for people when they do things that are wrong. And again, in the case of Florida, the school dealt with some of the issues internally, and the shooter there, he did things that were illegal. I mean, he held his gun to people's head. That would have put him in jail, but the school dealt with a lot of those things internally, and the sheriff's department didn't make arrests when they could have. So there was a failure of multiple layers. I mean, first, the failure of the school district because of their policy of dealing with things internally and not involving the police, and then there was the failure of the FBI, and then there was the failure of the police on scene that day. And so with all those failures in place, I think that's why some of the focus on guns and gun control is misplaced.
All right. Patrick.
All right. Coming up, more from the students. We're in Milwaukee at Rufus King High School asking students, should teachers be armed?
What if students get it? Or what if a teacher, somehow gets upset and tries to threaten us with it?
More responses from students, and our conversation continues right here in the studio coming up next. And we're also asking you as well on Twitter, should assault weapons be banned? Vote in our poll, and we'll have reaction at the end of the show. Students walked to the state capitol in Madison today calling for stricter gun laws in schools. Welcome back. We are having an in-depth conversation tonight about guns and schools.
12 News' Adrian Pedersen is live in Milwaukee at 18th and Olive at Rufus King High School in Milwaukee. And Adrian, the entire school walked out there.
Joyce, it appears all 1,500 students participated here today at Rufus King High School. They boiled their message down to gun control. After walking around the track for 17 minutes to honor the 17 who died in the Parkland, Florida school shooting, students broke the silence.
Protect children, not guns. Gun violence is public enemy number one. We will continue to stand up and lead the way to make a change.
These adults that are saying that we can't act upon things are the people who aren't acting upon things. If you have a problem with something and you have the ability to vote, vote out the people who are pro-gun.
Not one more. Students also talked about gun violence outside of school and in the neighborhood.
I don't live in, like, you know, the best part of Milwaukee, and honestly, every day as I walk to the bus or walk home, I'm just scared and I'm anxious about somebody coming up and pulling out a weapon that they shouldn't even have access to.
A lot of students out here today got emotional exactly like that, and they said they're taking action as well this upcoming week and writing letters to lawmakers to make sure their voices get heard for these stricter gun laws. Joyce.
And Adrian, you also had a chance to talk to students about arming teachers.
That's right. I talked to several students as well as the superintendent and just asked that outright. Do you think teachers should be armed? Here's what they had to say.
I don't think weapons have any sort of place within education, and I just don't think it would make me as a student feel safe.
What if students get it, or what if a teacher, I don't know, somehow gets upset and tries to threaten us with it? I just wouldn't feel safe at all.
What then would be the teacher's responsibility? At what point would they be expected to jump in?
Do you think teachers should be armed?
Absolutely not. That is void of reason and rational thought. I think, honestly, it's an excuse to not really deal with the real challenges that we're having. Schools are our safe havens. They are safe harbors. They are lighthouses in our communities. And the idea of putting any type of weapon in a school is absolutely ludicrous.
Some people just cannot control their rage. And if you put somebody in the wrong situation at the wrong time, that can just escalate.
I don't think that we should be arming teachers whatsoever at all. I think it's impractical. I think it's an alternative for lawmakers who are not willing to stand against the issue.
In schools here where we can't even afford to lock up things like field trip money, I don't understand how teachers would ever be able to have the proper training and resources to use a gun in schools.
I asked about 10 students that very question. They all told me pretty much the same thing. They do not want their teachers to have guns. Joyce.
Adrian Pedersen live at Rufus King High School in Milwaukee.
We want to talk to our panel right now. You heard from the students about arming teachers. As we just heard, many of them said that they don't want their teachers armed. Nick Clark, I want to start with you. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, first, unfortunately, I think schools are a place where over the years there's been a lot of demonization of guns, first becoming, obviously, with them being no-gun zones. And then the things, I mean, you can't even chew a Pop-Tart in the shape of a gun without receiving punishment. So there's just been this demonization. So I'm not surprised the kids at the school age don't understand guns and have kind of an ingrained fear built into them. In fact, that's one of the things that I think is part of the resistance to having guns in schools, is because schools on the political side don't want to consider that. They don't want that to be a solution. I think everybody wants to stop school shootings, but I think some people aren't willing to let that be the solution, because that would really challenge the narrative that we've heard in schools over the years that guns are bad, guns are bad. I also think students don't understand what the how that would be implemented. In Ohio, they do this. They have a lockbox. So I heard on today on the news, one student said, well, is a teacher just going to have a gun sitting on a desk? Obviously, that's not how the actual program is implemented. There's a lockbox, biometric lockbox. It's only activated from a fingerprint. And then in this particular school in Ohio, they have a bulletproof vest there as well in the closet. And so if a school shooting happens, they can lock the door. The teacher can access the bulletproof vest and the gun. And ultimately, that's the only person that the students can count on for their safety, because as we saw in Florida, the FBI can fail, the criminal justice system can fail, and the police won't even come into the school when the shooting is taking place. The teacher's the only one they can count on for their self-defense.
Well, Representative, we're hearing from students and from others that they want action from lawmakers. Is this something that you would support, arming teachers?
Well, first of all, there is no proposal in Wisconsin to arm a teacher. We passed last month a bill that would reimburse schools on a grant-type basis to have armed security guards or officers in the school. But for the actual idea of a teacher, There's about 8 to 10 school districts around the country or states that are doing this right now, and we don't see a major problem with them, but it's all in the implementation. I think that that's a decision that the local school district should make. But if you take a look in Oklahoma, for example, the schools down there, the teachers, you know, it's not every teacher can just carry a gun and that's the end of it. If you want to do that, you go through a very extensive training course. In fact, they train the teachers in Oklahoma. They go through a tougher course than the police officers actually do. They have a higher rating for as far as their target shooting, and they have to go to a range 4 times a year to practice. So, I mean, they are very highly trained, but it's a voluntary basis, and again, it's up to the school district to do. I think that, you know, we take a look at, we have security guards, armed guards, and police at sporting events, festivals, at Summerfest, everywhere you go, you're protected there, right? So you want to have that first line of defense. In some instances, police are only minutes away, but in some areas, the police are much more than that, you know, 10, 15, 20 minutes away. So if you had somebody in that school that was able to take on a shooter and prevent harm, you know, I think that's a viable option in a lot of cases, and we shouldn't just automatically rule it out.
All right, there's much more to get to, so we're going to have you sit tight. We have another topic we want to talk about. Joyce?
And coming up, we head to Whitefish Bay High School. We asked the question, how do you make schools safer?
I don't think anyone really has a, like, complete, like, 100%, like, foolproof answer.
More from students and our gun activist guests when we return. Welcome back to our 12 News special, Guns and Schools.
Let's go now to Whitefish Bay High School. 12 News' Kent Wainscott is there right now. And Kent, students walked out onto the football field there earlier today.
Yeah, that's right, Patrick. The event here at the high school included an event that played out here on this football field behind me. It was carefully planned. It was well coordinated, often solemn at times, and included a pointed message from students who were hoping to start a broader conversation.
Students gathered in the center of the Whitefish Bay football field to share what, for many of them, is a growing concern.
We don't feel safe to go to school right now, and that shouldn't really be something that we have to worry about. If there's ever been a time to start these conversations, now is the time.
There was a moment of silence, and the names of the Parkland shooting victims were read, and the students launched an ongoing discussion about school safety.
We're not saying that the answer is to ban all guns, and we're not saying the answer is to arm all teachers. It's just beginning to listen to each other.
Nearby, off the school grounds, a crowd gathered to support the students.
You felt it was important to be here.
Yes, because they are the ones who are going to bring about change.
It's a mission these young people seem ready to accept.
It's something that we're all going to be working towards because we are the voice of the future.
And they're hoping their voice is heard, Patrick.
You were able to talk with the students off school grounds about a specific topic.
Yeah, some here off the school grounds and others actually through the fence here after that event wrapped up. We started a conversation of our own with them about school safety. How do you make schools safe?
Well, we definitely believe that guns are a part of that equation, and it makes up a big part. And we are asking for gun reform.
What has to happen to make schools safe?
I mean, I don't think anyone really has a, like, complete, like, 100%, like, foolproof answer.
It's not about, you know, what's happening in November or what's happening in 2020. It's about getting a long-term fix that really caters to the needs of everyone. It's not about, you know, just, you know, political fix.
Our generation is establishing that we will not be complacent with these issues and that we are willing to use our voices to speak up.
But some of you have said, I don't feel safe in school.
Yeah.
What has to happen to make you feel safe in school?
We have to address it. I think we don't usually have a platform to do so, and I think today's march is an excellent opportunity to begin advocating for our beliefs and our concerns.
And they're hoping it all leads, of course, not only to a broader discussion, but also to action, to positive steps to help ensure school safety. Patrick.
All right, some candid comments. Kent Wainscott live in Whitefish Bay tonight. Joyce?
All right, so let's hear from our panel once again. How do you make schools safer? And we'll start with you, Representative.
I think it's important to have a solid safety plan in place that's reviewed not only with the teachers in each school, but also with local law enforcement, so everybody knows what to expect. You could start by, you know, making sure that protocol is followed, right? If you have doors, make sure that they're locked, make sure that the glass is bulletproof at the entranceways, make sure you have just a real good protocol in place, and then follow your instincts more or less. When something doesn't look right, do something about it, as opposed to what we've seen in Florida where they didn't do anything about it. But those are the types of things that, you know, you can take and take care of the building itself. But as one of the students even mentioned, there is no foolproof answer, because you can make that building inside as secure as possible, but once the kids walk out that door, then you have that threat again. And the sad part is, in some parts of Milwaukee, you're in much more danger just walking down the street than you are at school, yet we don't see a big uproar about what's happening in the community, unfortunately, there. The focus is on the school, and that's not to minimize what happens in the school, but when we have an overall crime problem in our society that goes well beyond the schools, and we should be focusing on justice in all of these situations.
May I ask you, because the legislation is within your domain, about red flag laws, which essentially allow police to confiscate weapons after a court deems someone mentally unstable or someone in a mental crisis. Five states have such a law now. 19 others are considering it. Would you back such a provision if Wisconsin were to introduce something like that?
So I think you'd have to kind of take a look at what each specific proposal is. I have not seen anything that really is, again, can bring it right down to, you know, how do you determine that, right? Because unfortunately, you know, you have a judge making a decision. Now, they're going to have an expert involved. You could get many doctors, different doctors, to come up with different diagnoses. I think we all want to try to be sure that anybody who shouldn't have a gun because they have mental health issues doesn't have one. There are plenty of laws on the books that prevent that from happening right now. But, you know, with HIPAA laws and everything that are in place, it's very difficult to be able to make that determination as to who has an issue and who doesn't.
Go back to Patrick now.
All right, our conversation continues. We're asking you on Twitter, how can we make schools safer? Arm teachers, install metal detectors, increase security staff, do nothing. We'll talk about your answers with our panel coming up next.
And welcome back. We are finishing up with our panel with polls that we posted on Twitter. Our first question is the same that we posed to the students. Should assault weapons be banned? Here are the results. 62% say yes. And we have another question that we asked. Should teachers be armed? Here are the results. An overwhelming 87% say no. We want to ask our panel again about this. Representative, you said there's nothing pending right now regarding this, but this has been an issue. We've heard the president say that he's leaving the question of arming teachers to state and local governments. The governor has said that he doesn't support it. The attorney general has said that he's open to allowing teachers. I want to get your thoughts on this. Is this something that you would like to see come up here in Wisconsin, the idea of arming teachers?
I think it should be an option, again, for the local school district. But we're seeing where it's done in areas around the country. It's done perfectly safe, but it's all involved with the training, right? So I think when you look at those high results from your poll, people automatically assume, well, all you're going to need is a CCW permit and you're good to go. That's not the case when you look at any of these schools that allow that now. They have very strict training programs that are in place.
And Nick, your viewpoint on that?
Yeah, and again, I mean, I think it's the only solution that presents the best opportunity to stop these school shootings and deter them. I think deterrence would be a huge factor. And the fact is, we wouldn't have to arm every teacher, and I think that's why sometimes the implementation of this is what people don't understand, how this would actually happen. But if you had a lockbox in every single classroom and you only had 2 teachers out of 100 that had a gun, no students need to know which teachers have the gun and which don't. The states that allow this and the districts that do it, they put signs up that that the staff is armed. And I think that's a huge deterrent, even though it only takes 1 or 2 armed teachers. And the fact is, maybe in some of those schools some days none of the teachers are armed. But it's not about having teachers with a gun on their hip. It's really about that deterrent factor. Having lockboxes in the classroom that teachers can access. And I think it would start with just a couple teachers that would volunteer. And I know that these teachers exist because they contact me, and they're not willing to speak about it because they think that they would be ridiculed publicly. But I know there's a few teachers in every school that would be willing to do this.
We only have a few seconds left, but I want to go back to the students, because one of the students we heard from today said this is not an adult issue. They want to be heard. Do they have a seat at this table as we look forward to policies regarding guns in schools?
Yeah, I think their views are very important, and we will take them into consideration.
And the governor said no child should live in fear at school, and yet we heard from those kids today who said they do. So this conversation continues. We are out of time right now, and we'd like to thank everyone for participating, our panel, and our students.
And you can watch some of the highlights of our conversation coming up tonight at 10 o'clock. Until then, we want to say thank you and good night.